Welcome to Solugubrus podcast, and you can see me smiling and excited because today it's one of my favorite topics, science fiction, the topic that I have never spoken about on this podcast for a long, long time. In fact, never. I mean, this is my first time doing a science fiction related podcast, and who else but a science fiction writer himself, a writer on contemporary Indian culture, Vijendra Mohanty. You may be knowing him as Words of Weapons on his Twitter handle. Vimo World is his YouTube channel. And welcome to the podcast, sir. It's an absolute pleasure having you. I finally have a buddy to talk about. You're not my buddy, but finally someone to talk about, you know, science fiction among all my friend circle. Thank you for doing this.
No, it's okay. We can be buddies. That's all right. And as far as like the number of people in India who are willing to talk about or have an extensive conversation about science fiction, the number of such people is so low that whenever you find someone, you better make a buddy out of them.
Yeah,
otherwise you'll never find another one.
Exactly. Why is that the case, sir? Because, you know, wahi se shuru karte hain hum, I will keep it in mix of Hindi and English. Because my first memory, right? Meri first memory jo hai, it was Minority Report. There was this movie called Minority Report. That's my first thirst with science fiction. And it's very sad that I didn't start with something from Indian content, right? Why is that the case? Is there something missing here?
How old are you?
Let's not reveal that. I was born in 90s. Let me put it that way.
Okay. I was just wondering because in my head, Minority Report is kind of a later film.
Yeah.
Because I was born in 1983. Mm. And my first memory of science fiction films, at least, is, Universal Soldier and Star Wars and stuff like that. So Minority Report is quite a late development.
For me, it's the earliest one because I was born in the 90s because the movie came out in 2001, I believe. No,
I guess. I was in college then. I have my later half of my life, that memory has been assigned.
But how do you explain the lack of that content from Indian literature in a sense? Because where can we find this? Because what we have is mythology, right? Our domination of our pop culture is all mythology than science fiction,
yeah.
Right? It's the reverse of what Americans do. Not saying that is good and this is bad or that is good, but it's a question nevertheless.
It has a good aspect and a bad aspect. Obviously, the bad aspect obviously being that a country's storytelling traditions get dominated by one kind of thing. For example, Hollywood is dominated by science fiction movies. In fact, their major output is science fiction and fantasy.
Yeah.
Romantic comedies are a small subgenre. Until the 90s, one of our major themes in cinema was love stories. So in that respect, we were very different. We did not have and still do not have a major science fiction storytelling tradition, at least in cinema.
Yes.
But as far as written science fiction goes, we have always had a good number of people doing it. I myself was quite unaware of it until, 5-6 years ago.
Right.
But since then, almost all science fiction I'm reading right now is by Indian authors.
Wow. Who can you point us towards for a start, for example? You can point me. Where can you point me?
You've obviously heard of Samit Basu.
Right. Yes.
Samit Basu, the author of Simokin Prophecies and Turbulence,
right,
and other novels. And there is Krishna Udayashankar, who writes fantasy, which might loosely be described as, inspired by mythology. There are also science fiction writers like Mimi Mondal, who is India's first nominee for the Hugo Awards.
Wow.
And there is someone called Vandana Singh, who has... who is quite well known in science fiction circles. Her science fiction short story collection is called Ambiguity Machines. And there are many other people also, like authors like Tashan Mehta, a novel by Prayag Akbar came out called Leela, which was also made into a Netflix series. So these things are happening all the time, and they're happening more and more, fortunately. So you may not have your buddy circle limited to just me in a few years.
Right. But is there a case for the fact that are we allowed to explore speculative fiction, right? Because, I mean, if you look at American shows, right, they explore something like, a man from high castle or like alternate history like Confederate or something. But here we couldn't even take Laila, for example, right? People are like pissed off, right? So
that's sad. That's sad. But as far as permission is concerned, I think writers have to give themselves permission to go in certain directions first. If you look for permission from society, you're never going to get it.
Right.
Every decent, half decent work of mythology also that has come out of India has been criticized by people who think that we should not talk about mythology in terms any different from devotion.
Right.
Which is sad, because that's how a storytelling culture dies. If you limit people's ability to imagine, to think about new things, to do new things, even with old stories, then you are essentially destroying your own culture. Because no culture, you know, culture is like water. Stagnant water becomes home to malaria wale mosquitoes. And water that flows becomes a river. And that's how things go into the future. Storytelling traditions, storytelling culture. You asked me about why we don't have a huge science fiction culture in India. That's because the West has a science fiction community. I first heard about, like, this question is asked to many science fiction writers in India. Why do we not have that kind of a culture? Why do, even with respect to comic books, why don't we not have DC Marvel? The first thing is that we do have things. People don't know about them. And the second thing is we don't have as much of a community around these, you know, these literary areas as Western countries do. They have conventions, fantasy conventions, science fiction conventions, conventions devoted to single franchises. We don't have. We have max to max. What we have had so far is Comic-Con India. So I am looking forward to the day when we have a fantasy slash science fiction convention in India. Already some attempts have been made towards it. A gentleman called T.G. Shenoy hosts the science fiction section of the Bangalore Literature Festival. So I was having a conversation with him some time ago, and he himself said that the plan is to eventually, hopefully, have a full and proper science fiction convention.
Yeah, I mean, can you imagine big directors coming to an Indian convention, right? Like, for example, Nolan coming down or Spielberg coming down. That should be the stage that it will be nice. Yeah. You know, this collaboration, this cross-culture collaboration around the world of science fiction community. But is there an argument to be made with the fact that because we already have a mythological background, right? We didn't need superheroes, right? Because Americans and West, as in general, they're not their cultural identity is not that deeply rooted with their religion, which is Christianity mostly. So they needed a new heroes, which kind of makes sense in their contemporary times, right? For example, it's like Superman is kind of an extension of Jesus Christ, right? In a sense. So yeah, is there an argument for that?
What is the argument you're talking about? That they don't have a basis for a mythology?
We have too much. So we don't need new comic book heroes, right? They didn't have one. So they created some.
I am of the opinion that every culture needs new stories, regardless of how many old stories they might have or might not have.
Right.
Now, because you brought up Superman and how he tends to be a Jesus Christ metaphor, Britain does not have its own mythology. Part of the reason J.R.R. Tolkien wrote Lord of the Rings was because he was of the opinion that Britain needs its own mythology. So he created one. Like, imagine a single person creating an entire mythology for his home country. Imagine that.
Right.
Our problem is that, you know, their problem is that they don't have a foundation to stand on. So they are having to build it.
Yes.
Our problem is that we are under the impression that we already have so much of a foundation that we don't need to build on top of it, which is, you know, frankly, just false. Because one of the most common messages a writer gets these days, especially if they dabble in science fiction, fantasy, mythology. I said fantology. Well, that's a nice word.
Yeah.
I just invented a word.
Yeah.
Science fiction, fantasy, mythofiction.
What's the point of being a science fiction writer if you don't invert words? Come on.
the message we get is that, why don't you do a rewriting of the Ramayana? And my response is slightly different from other people. Other people's response might be that I don't want to. Mine is that I've done it far too many times. I have done a comic book series based on Ramayana called Ravanayan. I have run a YouTube channel that was kind of based on the retellings from Hindu mythology. I'm tired of it. We really don't need more of those. every 2 years, somebody remakes the Ramayana. Every 4 years, somebody tries to do something with Mahabharata. Recently, Amir Khan was asked about his dream project, and he said he wants to make a Mahabharata in which he wants to play Krishna. The list goes on. Everyone is doing Ramayana or Mahabharata. There are very knowledgeable people who do film criticism who have told me that if you go look at every single Hindi movie ever made, the 90s or before that, you will find that the story is kind of sort of based on the Mahabharata because of, you know, family.
Even the very recent one, Rajneeti, is just basically Mahabharata.
Yeah. Exactly. And so these stories have a very strong hold on our heads. My thing is that even with when I'm not writing fiction, even when I'm writing non-fiction, you know, the kind of essays I write on my email newsletter about contemporary culture, etc. My thing is that if we get too caught up with our past, we are not going to pay any attention to our future.
Yes.
Even if our future is going to be based on our past, it still needs to be spelled out. It still needs to be, like, we can't be complacent about the future. We can't think that जो भी होना था वो सब हो चुका है, हमको कुछ भी नहीं करना है, अपने आप हो जाएगा आगे सब कुछ. The world is a very fast changing thing. We cannot rely on ancient glory, ancient mythology, ancient culture in order to build the future of India. That's not how things work. It won't work for any country. Why India only?
And it's just weird, right? Speaking of India, right? So we run behind science in our education system. We run behind math in our education system, but we are the least interested population in science fiction. How weird is that? How do you explain that thing, for example? Are we just this, we just follow math and science for aspirational reasons, just, you know, get ourselves a step ahead in the social hierarchical ladder and then forget about it?
Yeah, I think that the answer to that question can be twofold. The first one, obviously, is what you pointed out. Our interest in science is not something that leads to scientific curiosity or even a scientific temper.
Exactly.
Because we have had ministers, senior civil servants, even high court judges say really stupid shit about scientific truths.
Yes.
So that is not, our science education is obviously lacking in some way. When you have, you know, highly educated people in from the science fields sending you WhatsApp forwards about, the galactic center of the center of the galaxy is aligned with Earth in some because of some rituals and some stuff. So that kind of stupidity obviously is not, there is no getting around it. It would be understandable if these people were uneducated and you can tell them, listen, you're factually incorrect. But a lot of this actually tends from an overlap between art and science. Art in this case being religion. Religion takes the help of stories, right? Which might be described as fantasy. And these stories are so old and they have taken such deep hold in the minds of people that even actual scientific truth does not change their mind. So you might say these guys are fantasy science fiction super fans. Except that they're not actually, they don't realize that they are that. They have come to the conclusion that these stories are factually true. So that's one thing. The second thing is, science fiction does not necessarily mean that it needs to translate into scientific awareness. I grew up reading Asimov and Arthur C. Clarke. Who did you read? Not movies, but if you read science fiction,
right?
Who are some of the authors that you have read?
I'm mostly a movie. My consumption of science fiction is mostly movies and TV series. But yeah.
Okay. So I grew up reading science fiction written by white people, which is Isaac Asimov, Arthur C. Clarke, etc. And the problem there that I did not realize until quite later in my life, in fact, until 5 years ago, 6 years ago in my life, is that science fiction was heavily biased. That science fiction was heavily biased towards a privileged outlook. These people thought that the future is going to be predominantly technological. Now, you have seen post-apocalyptic movies, right? Where the world has ended because of one thing or the other. A virus happened, a war happened, something or the other happened. And then people are trying to build up in that post-apocalypse world. Now, these people who wrote the science fiction of yesteryears, the white people, they were looking forward sort of or warning against a future which might be very bad. But what has happened in the last few decades, last few years, whatever you want to call it, is that science fiction is now being written by people of color, people whose skin color is like yours or mine. The Native American population of America is living in a post-apocalyptic world. For them, the apocalypse already came and went.
Yes.
Right? So their apocalypse is not in the future. It's in the past. And the writing that is happening right now is looking towards a sociological future, not a technological future.
Exactly.
Where social justice is very important, where, like Leela was one example. You can have the most high-tech things in the world. You can have a governance system being run by technocrats and engineers and doctors, and you can still end up in a very regressive society.
Yes.
That is the reality that science fiction being written by people today is pointing at. And there has been, like, you know, there's been like a whole lot of stuff, a whole lot of controversy about this also. Like, there are white people who are of the opinion that why can't science fiction go back to the days when it was just pure wonder? We could write in rockets and
flying cars and
exactly
stuff like that.
So, and you know, science fiction of the past was kind of looking at the future from the point of view of the past. If the science fiction of today is going to remain relevant, if it's going to, like, hamare liye Isaac Asimov or Arthur C. Clarke jo the,
yes,
in order for the writers of today to become that for future generations, today's science fiction has to look at the future as it appears now.
Right.
And our future does not look very bright. I'm sure you are aware of that.
Yeah.
Like our cultural dogmas, our inability to look at reality, social reality, our our unwillingness to deal with social justice. These are all themes that need to be in science fiction today.
Right. But here's the thing, right? What science fiction thing should happen to make people feel okay with a series like this, right? Because why are people angry on a series like this? For example, is it that it's just showing it a mirror of a mirror image of what is happening? Or is it that they're kind of disturbed that their status quo is being disturbed by shows like this? Is that the case?
Yeah. Privilege is being questioned, and the privileged people are unhappy because they think that the only way the world is a just place is when they have everything. If their privilege is questioned, if they are told that you have something that, you know, other people don't have, if they are told that your what you assume to be normal is actually abnormal for most people. Like, you know, I gave the example of Native Americans.
Yes.
A Native American person goes to the white person and says that, listen, this thing, this world that you think is a beautiful, equal world is not equal, has never been equal. My entire people got wiped out in order for you to live in this normal world. That white person in that context would, you know, understandably feel attacked.
You're absolutely right, because this the science fiction movies of today's world have taken a turn in terms of the social character, right? For example, it started with I won't say it started with, but, you know, one of the biggest examples would be Black Panther, right? It is such a massive, like, statement from the film industry that, you know, they are looking at things differently. And many shows, like, for example, Watchmen, for example, which is if you have seen the Watchmen movie, right, it's such a white person narrative, the movie. But right now it is you know, delving into, you know, racial lines. You know what I mean? It's just I love the fact
you're talking about the Watchmen series?
Series, yes.
I haven't seen it. I've only seen the movie.
Right.
But I have read the comics.
But
I have not seen the series.
So, you mean, do you see anything from India taking such turns? Are we are just happy, you know, milking the old, good old tropes of, you know, misogyny and heroism, male worship in our action or science fiction narratives?
There recently was, I haven't seen this one. It's called Cargo. Apparently, it's on Netflix. Have you seen it?
No, actually, I have to.
I haven't seen it. I'm told it kind of takes, I'm told it's a good beginning. But because it deals with, I should not comment on it because I've not seen it.
Me too. Yeah.
Maybe just to mention that some such things are getting made.
Right.
And therefore we may be slightly optimistic about the future of, you know, cinematic science fiction in India.
Right. But the reality that is that the path that of the reality that the country is taking, which more or less is towards the situation that Leela tries to predict, right? So will we go through the cycle that Germans have went through by any chance? Let's do some speculative fiction, right? Let's just write the future in a sense. Let's try to be that computer from the Krish 3 movie or Krish 2 movie or whatever. Will we go through what Germany went through in the 1930s? Will we go through that entire cycle? Or, you know, this is a very pessimistic statement, obviously, but one of my friends says, like, dude, there are something called elections, you know, cycles happen, right? There's a couple of election cycles, there'll be one regime, the next cycle, there'll be another regime. But do you think this is looking like a regime? I don't think it's looking like a regime to me. So
the possibility is very real, what you're afraid of. But I think there is less chance of us turning into a Germany and more chance of us turning into an Iran. You know, the cultural revolution that happened in Iran, where, you know, the entire official mechanism is was made theological, Islamized. I am afraid that, you know, India is too large and too multi-party to become a Germany overnight, because, you know, we are looking at farmer protests right now. To use a very colloquial term, किसी के बाप का देश नहीं है. ऐसे ही overnight आके कोई मतलब बोलेगा हाँ मैं भगवान हूँ और सब लोग मान लेंगे, ऐसा नहीं होने वाला. Yes, there will be opposition, there will be oppression against that opposition. Those things will happen. This is not going to be Germany. There is risk of that happening to a certain class of people who will become convinced that we are superior and that we deserve everything. And nobody else deserves everything because anything, because they are impure and we are pure, which is what Leela was going for. But I think there is more of a chance of this happening in a slow way, and we becoming a quote-unquote Hindutva nation, like Iran became an Islamic, you know, kingdom, for lack of a better word. An Ayatollah sort of version from the Hindutva quarters. Something like that is more likely. It's not going to happen. Like, I'm sure if someone is afraid that over the next 2 months we are going to become Hitler's Germany, that is not going to happen.
No.
Neither is India Germany, nor is the world of today that world, right?
But everything will be broadcasted. Everything will be backlashed.
Sab yaad rakha jayega. And the chances of us becoming an Iran are greater in my mind, which is why everyone who thinks that this problem is going to be solved by getting rid of one government is not thinking through it. This is not a one government problem. This is a people problem. It is going to have a people. It is going to have a people solution.
But this is the result of multi-decade, how can you, public opinion engineering, right? It started from the 80s in a sense, right? From you know, the temple issue and the Rath Yatra and so on. What reverse engineering do you foresee that should happen and someone should undertake? I mean, why is it that engineering a comforting lie is easier than engineering a brutal truth in someone's mind? Because why does shit news go faster on WhatsApp than actual real news?
Well, part of it is because our news systems never adapted to the rapid rise of the technological social media reality. Until, like, when blogging came along, I remember there were journalists on NDTV who were doing shows like, is blogging a threat to journalism? If every time a technological thing happens, an advancement happens, you start thinking of it as a threat.
Yes.
Instead of embracing it and wondering how to make this work for us, for the betterment of everyone, then, you know, people who have ulterior motives will take that chance from you. You will stand in one place, pointing at something new and saying, this is a threat, this is a threat, this is a threat. And they will say, this is an opportunity. And they will use it, which is exactly what happened in India. The right wing took advantage of technological realities changing very fast. The left did not. The liberals did not. Hum log apne, matlab, I know, jaise ki, suppose the social engineering experiment in the pro-Hindutva direction that you're talking about.
Yeah.
Started a long time ago.
Yes.
What should have started, which what should have happened simultaneously with it, is a, you know, parallel social movement to strengthen ties between community.
Right.
The only place where it was happening was in movies. You know, we saw movies where people of multiple religions, communities, etc., were hanging out together, having adventures, etc. When in reality, people won't even go to the cinema with the people with, you know, with in at least small towns and villages, which are extremely divided.
Yep.
So we need a nationwide unity movement. And that movement also is not going to start because of one protest. It's going to have to happen in the hearts of everyone. So we can sit at home. We can, you know, talk about how the government should do this, the government should do that. The activists should do this or that. If we have not succeeded in convincing our own families that India belongs to everyone and not just people who belong to our own community, then this is not going to work.
But if the left wing adapts the methods of right wing, right, by capturing the media, by capturing the, you know, by suppressing the dissent, right? So for example, some critics argue that what's wrong in suppressing a bigot? What's wrong in suppressing a racist, for example, right? So what happens if we give them the taste of their own medicine? Like for some examples were like, you know what, Nehru should have banned RSS long time ago, or you know, someone XYZ should have banned some XYZ long time ago. But is that the right way to go? Because ultimately, it's not the state who should suppress, right? It's the public opinion who should suppress, and that should be the ideal state to exist. That should be the ideal society to exist, right?
So, usme bhi matlab do cheez hai. Ek ye hai ki, you know, the RSS and the RSS thought process, the Hindutva line of thinking, has been at the receiving end of criticism for a number of years.
Right.
What happened in the last 6 years is that people from that, like, you know, like in Donald Trump's America, he was only in power for 4 years. But what did he do? He took people who agreed with him and put them in positions of power.
Exactly.
He created a culture where jo cheez pehle bolne se pehle log 6 baar sochte the, log kya kahenge? Ab log khullam khulla bol rahe hain. So what he did was that he created a culture of acceptance for bigoted ideas. And what he used for it was the argument that free speech matters. Sure, free speech matters. But there is also an argument out there that says that free speech has kind of failed us. Like the idea that free speech, if we allow everyone to say everything all the time, only the best ideas will come to the top. What we forgot was that in an environment where ideas are actually moving very fast, it is also possible to game that system. It is also possible to make some ideas look more popular than they actually are. And when you do that, when someone succeeds in doing that, even people who are not subscribers of that idea, they will start thinking, oh yeah, they are winning. Oh yeah, we are weak. Oh yeah, we don't have you know, much support.
Right.
So this gaming has happened for quite some time. What needs to happen is that obviously free speech is of paramount importance and it needs to be encouraged. And by the way, when I say free speech should be encouraged, I mean that the government should stop, clamping down on free speech.
Because it reminds
someone enters your house and decides to sing a song, you have the right to kick him out.
Yeah.
If you don't like the song, because or even if you don't like the
song. I would like to remind the listeners to a line that you wrote in your article where it says this free speech is between you and your state.
Yeah.
It's not between you and the other one. So you had you kicked one person out of Facebook or something like that.
Yeah, no, plenty of people, like, it happens every single day. Today, I kicked out someone who was, I didn't like what he said, and who was also encouraging a certain sort of, defeatism. I blocked someone. They created a separate account, came back and said, you're exactly like the Modi government. And I was going to, I came like 2-3 minutes late to the podcast because I wanted to reply to them, but then I decided I will do it later. So I'll tell you what I wanted to write to them. I said, I'm not the Modi government. I'm not the Congress government. I'm not any government. Free speech is an argument you should have with the people who are above you. If you have never questioned Narendra Modi about the clamping down on journalists' freedom, et cetera, don't come to me telling me that you have the right to write what you want in my Instagram comments. This is not a public space. This is my profile. I'll kick you out if I don't like you. Free speech is between you and the government that you exist under.
And the public place where you, right? So your right to be heard in a public place is where the freedom of speech works. Yeah, as you said, you can't come to.
You have the right to free speech. You do not have the right to reach. It is not my job to make sure everyone hears you.
Yeah.
I have a platform where I will talk about things that I want to talk about. If you want a platform, build your own fucking platform. Sorry.
It's just an uncensored podcast. Don't worry about it. But do you think, will we reach a point because of everything, getting centralized in a sense? Do you think we will reach a point where we won't have elections in a sense because it will look so pointless at the national level?
I don't think so. I don't think so.
Right.
I think that the intention of some people to make that a reality is obviously there. It is clear.
Right.
We have had a home minister who was giving a speech in the middle of, September of 2019. The home minister said, we should start questioning the multi-party system. right?
Right.
And then December happened, and then Jamia happened. I think in the middle of 2019, some people were very excited about the possibility of all that happening. But tab se lekar ab tak unko itne joote pad chuke hain ki I don't think anyone will talk about that for some time.
Right.
The idea is not gone, but they will kind of not raise it for some time because, you know, they are having to run all over India to even, you know, do campaigning for civic polls of all
Correct.
Things. So it is in their interest to have one country, one election. It is not in anyone else's interest.
Mm.
State elections happens, national elections happen, and elections are such a core part of India for
yeah.
like since independence that the people themselves will ask election kyun nahi ho raha.
Exactly.
What happens often is that we start thinking of the mood of urban India as the mood of India.
Mm.
Most the people who are the most ardent voters live in villages and small towns.
The turnouts in the cities are shit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Turnout in cities is shit. Bangalore is, you know, Bangalore, Mumbai, Delhi, these are every election. They're such disappointments.
Yes. And
you compare that to the voter turnout in a village and your mind will be blown.
Right. Like,
everyone considers it their sacred duty to go cast their vote, regardless of who they vote for. India is a country where people are extremely excited about elections. Every election, you must have seen this, like,
yep.
it feels like a festival.
Right.
It feels like a festival
right.
all over India.
Yeah, I remember the entire Bangalore was just empty because everyone went back to their hometowns just before the election night. The traffic was just bonkers, right? So people will revolt on that. But on the other hand, do we have a weird fantasy? We, as much as we hate China, right? We secretly love China, right? For the amount of, right? For the way they get things done, right? It doesn't matter how we get things done.
Yeah.
But we have a weird fantasy with China and you know, we would like to, you know, implement what we want to do with stamping authority, right?
Yeah, that's because our culture is very, like, you know, it's a culture that extends from our homes to our polity.
Right.
Dande padenge to samajh mein aayega, bado se aise kaise baat karta hai, this bending before authority and expecting people to cooperate, because we are a very social place. We are not a very individual place. We are our social culture, not an individualist culture. So what happened, and it's a strange thing really, because our social culture creates an atmosphere where voting happens more than it happens in individualist cultures like America. Mm. Because they, for example, I think they have sort of been a democracy for so long that they have started taking it for granted.
Yeah.
And in India, most people who vote are the underprivileged people.
Yes.
The people, like, you know, who will vote and who will not vote? The people who don't vote are people whose lives are not affected by voting.
Exactly.
The roads are there, the buses are there, the office is there. But the person for whom voting is the difference between having a citizenship or losing it is definitely
having a road to his village or not.
Exactly. Even forget roads. It's much more, these days, it's much more basic, right?
Right.
If you don't vote, if you don't vote against the party that is trying to declare that you are not an Indian, then you're fucked.
Yeah.
You're fucked, completely fucked. It's such a basic thing now.
Right.
So obviously voting, you know, I kind of have forgotten what the question was about, but I hope that answers it.
But what will solve all this, right? Because every, like, one of the most simplistic things to like look at the world is like, yeah, all these social divisions, they only exist in countries that are not well off economically, right? That have been robbed by the Western countries. The ones who have the developed countries, right? They don't have too many problems like we have because they have money. So the thing is, every problem in India is just boiling down to like, apne paas apna desh gareeb hai, right? Apne paas paisa nahi hai. So will paisa solve everything? Like, for example, if there is some sort of a gold...
No, I don't think that is...
If there is a gold asteroid, for example, that crashes on India and we secretly, hide that from the world and start selling that gold, will it transform our country in a matter of 10 years?
No, I don't think so. I think that's a very Chetan Bhagat argument. Mm. I don't think that is true. Chetan Bhagat is not an ex. I don't know why that interview went out where he said people still see India as a poor country. Mm. Hamara problem ye nahi hai ki hum log rich nahi hai. Mm. Hamara problem ye hai ki hum log casteist hai. हमारा प्रॉब्लम यह है कि वी बिलीव इन डीप सोशल डिविजन्स No amount of money is going to take that away. No amount of poverty is going to solve it. It is going to happen through social change.
वो गोल्ड एस्टेरॉयड का पैसा अंबानी अदानी के पास ही जाएगा, अपने पास थोड़ी आएगा।
पहली बात तो गोल्ड एस्टेरॉयड अगर आकाश में दिखा तो सबको दिखेगा The number of people who will die because of that impact, I don't think gold or titanium or rock or iron will make a difference.
Yeah, but the thing is, right, like for example, everyone has a resource to sell, right? For example, like Saudi, Saudi was this tribal community. All of a sudden it went to building the largest skyscraper in the world because they discovered oil 40 years ago or something like that, right? What should happen to India, right? There must be some turning point. Maybe suddenly world needs a lot of lithium or uranium that's available in India that's discovered all of a sudden. So what will change?
I think India's greatest export has always been talent.
Hmm.
You know, talented people, people who know how to do
manpower.
Things. Not when you say manpower, it feels like we're selling slaves.
Right.
But I mean, in the early 2010s, we were talking about our demographic dividend. We had a lot of young people who should have been given a good education so that they can become useful resources that we can send out of the country. Hmm. And that will, you know, we will have people there. In due course of time, we will have say in politics everywhere. In due course of time, we will, you know, you get the idea.
Right.
What happened instead was that the one place where we decided to expand our skill base was engineering. Hmm. Engineering colleges sprouted up everywhere. Now, beech mein ek time tha when we were producing too many engineers.
Yes.
We couldn't employ them.
Yes.
And उसके बाद प्रॉब्लम आया कि जो इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेजेस इतने सारे बन गए थे कि मोस्ट ऑफ द इंजीनियर्स बीइंग क्रिएटेड बाय दोज कॉलेजेस वर इनकॉम्पिटेंट, दे डिडंट नो हाउ टू डू थिंग्स. सो वी आल्सो नीड सम अमाउंट ऑफ डाइवर्सिफिकेशन इन टर्म्स ऑफ हाउ वी डिफाइन टैलेंट.
यस,
राइट. द ओनली थिंग, इफ द ओनली थिंग वी कैन गिव टू पीपल इज पीपल इज आईटी पीपल, देन वी आर, यू नो, फॉर अ सर्टेन ड्यूरेशन ऑफ टाइम इट लुक नाइस. But we need to, you know, diversify the definition of what we are giving the world. Agar humko puri duniya ko talent dena hai, to wo talent sirf engineer nahi ho sakta. Ya sirf doctor nahi ho sakta. It has to be other things also.
But again, we are relying on the world to employ us, right? For example, like, I mean, the reason why we don't have other, you know, like, I don't see any other career that pays me like 25,000 rupees per month in my first job other than an engineering or an IT job, right? Why is that the case? Why are we stuck here in this engineering paradox?
It goes back to your first question. Because we thought that engineering and medical are going to save us, we put all our efforts into growing those sectors. We didn't grow the other sectors. Log kahan se aayenge? Ek, hum wo cheeze sikhayenge nahi. B, जो लोग वो चीजें खुद सीखेंगे हम उनके लिए एम्प्लॉयमेंट प्रोवाइड करने की कंडीशन में नहीं है. सी, अगर किसी तरह किसी ने वो सब सीखा और अपने आप को एम्प्लॉय कर भी लिया तब भी मतलब क्या, लाइक दैट पर्सन इज नॉट गोइंग टू स्टे इन इंडिया बिकॉज द मार्केट इज नॉट हियर.
राइट.
सपोज समवन बिकम्स एन आर्टिस्ट, जस्ट ऑफ द टॉप ऑफ माय हेड, हु वाज नॉट टॉट आर्ट, हु टॉट हिमसेल्फ आर्ट, हु बिकेम एन आर्टिस्ट, हु बिकेम अ वर्ल्ड फेमस आर्टिस्ट, हु इज अ कॉन्सेप्ट आर्टिस्ट फॉर हॉलीवुड स्टूडियोज नाउ. Why is he not finding work in India? Because we don't have need for that kind of a person.
Yeah.
So a huge part of diversifying our definition of talent is also creating markets. Right? And that also, obviously, jaise matlab, you spoke about why are all our talented people leaving. Our talented people are leaving because there is nothing for them to do here.
Right.
Even if you create a lot of engineers and those engineers are substandard, you know, they can't do their stuff. विदेश छोड़ो, उनको देश में भी कौन नौकरी देगा? We need to build the markets here. Sure, we will. Those markets will also be advantages to foreign companies, foreign entities, etc. But अगर मार्केट होंगे ही नहीं तो वो टैलेंट आएगा कहां से और आएगा क्यों?
Right. And why should we rely on politicians to change all this? Right? Because ultimately, a politician is serving as investor. right, who's funding his career. So why should I not be pessimistic that nothing is going to change? I'll just better move the fuck out of here.
Well, your question is, why should we rely on politicians? The answer is, we should not rely on politicians.
Right.
We should not rely on politicians because at the end of the day, as I said, social change is not brought about by a single political party. It is going to be brought about by social movements.
Right.
What is happening right now? The farmers' protest is going on in Delhi.
Mm-hmm.
One of their slogans is "Kisan Mazdoor Ekta," right? So the people who work, which by the way includes people who are engineers, people who are in white collar jobs, etc., who don't see themselves as laborers, despite the fact that they are very clearly laborers.
I would like to point the article for the folks who what Mr. Vijendra is talking about.
You can put it in the description of the podcast.
Yes.
So the idea is that if we, the people, are unaware of who we are, then it becomes easier for the unscrupulous politician that you mentioned, who is only worried about his own career, his own image, etc. It only becomes easier for them because they have no interest in making the people stronger. They have an interest in building a base of supporters. And if in order to do that, they have to lie to you, steal from you, steal from one person and tell them that, I didn't steal it. Those people did. People from that religion did. आपस में एक दूसरे को लड़ा के उनका करियर आगे बढ़ जाएगा पर हमको कुछ भी फायदा नहीं होगा और हमें फायदा तब होगा when we realize that we are all in the same boat. That right. when they make a law which is oppressing a certain category of people, it is actually a bad thing for everyone, not just that category of people.
Yes.
You can't have a country where there is a class of population who you are okay if they are oppressed, and then you hope that in that culture you will never be oppressed.
Yeah, it's you can be in the line. You may be the next in line. Who knows?
Yeah. Right. You are definitely going to be in the line. Who? Anyone who thinks that, unhone wo kanun banaya hai sirf un logo ke liye, mera kuch nahi hoga, that person is a donkey. And sooner or later, that person will realize that he's a donkey.
Right. But what can possibly get rid of caste system in this country, right? Because genetically, we are so undiversified in terms of population, right? We have literally no cross genetic, no crossing of the genetics from centuries, from millennial. We all have the same blood, and we are weirdly proud in that blood, right? And reservations, their job is to like bring that gap closer, and they are doing their job, but how much can they do, right? I mean, there's only so much they can do, right? What else are we missing here in terms of this fight to narrow this gap?
See, this is going to be such a long fight that I can only point at the first step of it. Ye karo, uske baad baaki cheeze follow karengi. And that first step is first acknowledging that the problem is there. Hum log abhi wahan pe bhi nahi pahunche hain. We are at a point where if you bring up the caste system, most people will say, ये तो बहुत पहले होता था, आजकल नहीं होता, और that मैंने तो कभी नहीं किया.
This, and the point is that fascinating fact, right? This is something that really shocked me. Sorry to interrupt. I was in the exact same mindset. Like, caste system only happens in villages, right? Okay, the houses are separate in the villages, right? And then I saw the data, right, from the metros. We're talking about Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, and all these cool metros that invite metal bands and shit, right? So it's like, even there, right, only 4% of the 5% of the population marries outside their caste. Only 4%, 5% population of the marries outside their religion, right? So even in cities, which is seemingly this, seemingly democratic in terms of its spread, right, it's not at all democratic. It's deeply divided. At least, it's divided right down to your genetics.
Yeah, I mean, it's divided even on the on profession lines. You find people who do sanitation work, ask them their caste, and you will see it. Most people are like, just because they have a job, they get a salary, etc. There is no discrimination. As if people from upper caste families aspire to become a drain cleaner one day. They don't. Obviously, they don't. And as I said, the first step has to be awareness that this is a problem. The second step needs to be, acknowledging that if you are an upper caste person, you are part of the problem, regardless of whether you have actively discriminated against people on the basis of
caste. You're the beneficiary.
Yeah, you're the beneficiary. You may not have actively discriminated, but you have passively discriminated. Discrimination has happened on your account, and you are answerable for it. Utana humility, agar we manage to bring in a significant number of people, we will be on our way to solving this problem. But then again, most people in India don't live in cities. Most people in India are not going to listen to this podcast. So our efforts need to be pointed in the general direction of aiding and supporting, political entities,
right,
who are actively anti-caste, actively anti-caste. Donate to them, learn about them, spread the word about them, talk to those people, give those people platforms. And if you can't do any of it, at least don't be blind to the reality that this is a problem that needs to be solved.
And the weird thing is, right, the caste that is dominant is just 20% of the population, right? It's not even like 60%, right? What is this weird thing, right? So for example, many people ask this, like, how can that happen? Like, for example, if you look at countries around the world, like, for example, if you take Iraq, right? Iraq is basically a Shia community, but the ruling class is Sunni, which is like 20% of the population. You take Syria, majority is Sunni, but the ruling population is Shia, Bashar al-Assad. I mean, and if you dial back a little bit, I mean, the populations of the populations of the Western countries that had colonies is just a fraction of their colonies, right? Like, how can England possibly occupy India, right? It's such a massive population and so on, right? So how does this concentration of power happen? What is your general observation that you have seen around the world? What is the common thread, in a sense?
I think it's because oppression, we assume that oppression is mostly physical, but it's also mental. It's also mental, spiritual to some extent, where after, one of the greatest complaints of the Hindutva Brigade is that humko Mughlon ne dabaya tha, humko Britishers ne dabaya tha, isliye hum aise hain. And the solution, they say it from a point of view of privilege, because right now they're not being oppressed. They just want a justification to, continue being how they are.
Relevant, yeah.
But what happens is that though they are not oppressed, there are people who are oppressed and are still being oppressed. And those people have very genuine reason for being the way they are. So it is completely possible for a culture to exist, a culture of, low self-esteem, a culture of... how do I put this without making actual oppressed people sound like Hindutvavadis? Because Hindutvavadis are not a culture where you start thinking of yourself as less than the person who belongs to the privileged community, which is oppressing you.
Right.
This happens to this, somebody was talking about some time ago, what it means to be black in America. Like what do you get from your parents? You get a house, you get some money, you get memories, you get legacy. Like my grandfather was a general in the army. What do you get if you are black? You get homelessness. You get parents who never had enough money to support you. If you are Dalit in India, you might even get cleaning drains as a legacy. Imagine what that does to your psyche. Imagine what that does to your self-image. Imagine what you grew up thinking of yourself as. In that kind of a situation where a person or a community does not even the right to think of themselves.
And here's the thing. Here's one more thing, right? So I always had this fascination that, white people invent everything. They must be the most talented people in the world, right? Because every single invention around the world, you look at aeroplane, petrol, car, everything happens from white people. I thought, okay, because maybe we are not talented and they're talented. It is only when I grew up, I realized that talent comes out of privileged communities mostly, right? And India is a supreme example of that, right? Because, the most famous example would be our cricket team. Yeah. Where is the talent coming from? Just take a look at their names. It's just so evident. Yeah.
And I think it's also a matter of, like you pointed out, it's a matter of privilege, obviously. But it's also a matter of some story is not being told.
Yeah.
Right?
Talent
on Twitter, somebody...
Talent is not exactly natural. It's not natural. Yeah. Talent is just bullshit in my head. Sorry, go on.
Like you gave the example of cricket. I'm not a huge cricket watcher. I'm not at all a cricket watcher, in fact. Mm. But I have to imagine that a young person believing whether or not they can become an expert cricketer is also a result of them having heard stories about Sachin Tendulkar. Right? You heard stories about white people, but you did not hear stories about brown people inventing stuff.
Yes.
Which is where science fiction and fantasy kind of come in. Because if you had heard those stories, like I'll tell you, when I was growing up, I was watching a lot of fantasy, like, you know, Flash Gordon, superheroes, etc. I did not think Indian people could be heroes until the age of 10. When I started reading Raj comics, where the superheroes were called Nagraj and Super Commando Dhruv and Suraj and stuff like this. So I thought, hey, these guys are Indian. They can have extraordinary adventures. They can fight aliens. And that, it clicks something in your head. Like, as a child, you need to be able to see yourself in a story. And I had friends in college who had only read American novels. And when they tried to write stories, they could not set them in India.
Yes.
They could not do it. Their brains failed at it. So representation is very important. So there was a debate some time ago, right? Women in armed forces. Recently, we made it possible.
Yeah.
When that was happening, there were debates on Twitter about women are worse fighters than men, etc., etc. And somebody was saying, "Acha, so find me one kingdom where women were the only rulers or they fought, etc." And there is an essay by a science fiction writer called Cameron Hurley called "We Have Always Fought." It's basically Cameron going to a person she knows and says, "Can you give me examples of women fighters across history?" And that person says, "Women have always fought. There are examples of women fighters, women generals, women kings, women squadrons fighting and winning wars right from the beginning." But we don't hear those stories. The only stories we hear are full of men fighting men.
Yes.
So those stories, if you tell stories about people doing things that they don't do, you make them capable of doing those things.
Right. So it's quite, so a Dalit cricketer will need a Dalit Sachin Tendulkar, obviously. He may get inspired by Sachin.
It depends on their self-image.
Yeah.
It is entirely possible for a Dalit. Like, you know, there are stories of people who will get inspired by looking at someone.
Yes.
And then make something of themselves only to come across a barrier which they did not know that it existed previously. Like they thought having brown skin makes them equal to that person. But turns out that person is also from a caste that is different from them.
Yes.
So sure, a Dalit kid, in order to think of themselves as something worthwhile, needs to be able to see a Dalit intellectual out there.
Yeah.
I've been watching videos by a Dalit intellectual called Suraj Yengde.
Yes, I by the way sent him a podcast request which he didn't respond. Sir, please, if you're watching this podcast, please, would love to. Sorry, go on.
Yeah, so that was my point. If people need to be able, like, you know, literature is a mirror of society. People say that log kehte na log, matlab, if they see a Shaktiman serial and somebody is flying after jumping from a roof, a child will try to jump and do the same. It does happen.
Yeah.
And when a child does that, the child dies, and that's not a good thing.
Right.
But that power of literature can also be put to good use. Show people doing things and they will emulate it. They will turn fantasy into reality.
That is the point of reservation, right? That is the point that people don't understand about reservation, right? Because the importance of representation is just so huge in like bringing up a community. And I'd like to point out towards, again, a cricket example, because I watched a lot of cricket. South African team, right? The reason why you have Rabada and Hashim Amla dazzling in the IPL is because those black cricketers were given a space in that team with a mandatory rule of, you know, 30% reservation in the team, right? Now, they may have had mediocre black cricketers in the beginning. They may have not, but who knows, right? But after a generation, we have some world-class players right now. right? So that happens, and we don't have the patience, and we live in a little attention span society where we expect entertainment in 15 seconds of TikTok videos. Nothing wrong against TikTok, but you know, do you think the patience of the current generation is going down? Do you think like, what is the future of like long books, big novels, movies? Is it going to stay? Is it going to go? Because our attention, there are so many things around us, the information, and our attention span is just so small. It's getting smaller. Where do you see this future going?
So before I go there, just I want to address one thing that you said about the cricket thing, where you know, you have to have a certain number of black players in the team, etc.
Right.
What happens often is that these black people in the team, I'm not a cricket person, I don't know what metaphor you're talking about, what example you gave.
Right.
But if I compare it to real world examples, what happens is that when a black person or a person from a minority or a marginalized community is put in a position where they are capable of doing something, they also have to measure up to extraordinarily hard standards.
Yes.
The same mistake, if they make it, those mistakes are 5 times bigger than the mistakes made by people who are considered to be the mainstream, quote unquote.
Yes.
So that's also there. It's not simply that the black, that the marginalized person lacks talent. It's also that they have to work 5 times as hard in order to be thought of as normal.
Yes.
So they're already battling overwhelming perceptive, barriers.
And this fantastic, two examples that come to my mind when you say this is, one is one of my aunts who lives in America just told me this week, you know why I respect Obama? Because Obama had to work 5 times harder to get where George Bush got or Clinton got himself. And
or Donald Trump. Look at someone who's a literal cabbage, Donald Trump can become prime minister, can become president just because he's white. Imagine how much Obama had to do to get there. Compare that to how much Trump had to do to get there.
And it's as if they expect this weird perfection from people who come from these communities, right? They're not supposed to go wrong. They have to be perfect. Like, for example,
the majoritarian community is making the rules, right? We are here to help you. We are here to judge you. And we will decide if you're worthy or not. Which is, it's completely unsurprising that people from marginalized communities are fucking pissed off. Like, I'll do my own thing among my own people. They will watch me. They will read me. You all can go fuck yourself.
Yeah. Like, for example, right? Like they point to someone like, say, for example, Owaisi, the politician Owaisi, right? So it's like, he makes some problematic statements. His brother has made some problematic statements, but that really becomes the danger of the country, while there is one statement per day from the saffron side, which really is just passed around like freaking WhatsApp forwards.
If you are from one community, you can do Ram 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 ka jab for 364 days, and on the 365th day you will say, oh fucking I'm tired. They will show the fucking I'm tired for 500 years.
Yes.
And if you're not from that community, no matter how much bullshit you swear, you're okay. You don't have to, the standards themselves are different.
One more example that Hasan Minhaj, the guy on the Netflix show, gives is, right, brown men and black men have to be extra hot to get acting chances, but white men can just look like weird, like mediocre looking. Nothing wrong with, I'm not trying to, objectify someone's looks, but you get the gist.
Yeah. No, I totally get it. Like, it's the same problem, just in a few different words, I guess.
Right.
But yeah, you were asking about something else when I digressed. You were asking about patience levels, right?
Yes. The social media. So, do you think, can I add to that question, right? Is there any coincidence with the rise of populism around the right-wing populism around the world with the rise of social media? Because this consumption of information, short information in bubbles, the rise of that culture and the rise of right-wing populism, is there a coincidence? Do you see any coincidence?
I think that we definitely do have a fragmentation of attention problem right now. which leads to people not being able to hold deep thoughts in their heads for long periods of time. I don't know if there is any evidence to suggest that the rise of right-wing populism has to do with it. It may as well have been left-wing populism. At the end of the day, we are tribal animals. So what we do is that we need things to build communities around.
That's right.
Now, these communities can be love-based. These communities can be hate-based. What we are looking at right now is rise of hate-based communities. In the 60s and 70s, America had a hippie problem, if you remember. those were love-based communities. I am only jokingly call it a hippie problem. But, you know, these things also happen.
Right.
Politics can be majorly decided by love or majorly decided by hate. It's just that the hate-based communities happen to have found a slice in human history
where they can broadcast themselves.
They can broadcast themselves. See, I'll tell you something. Sure, hate-based communities can broadcast themselves, but nothing stops love-based communities from broadcasting themselves either. At the end of the day, both are emotional responses to reality. So if love-based communities go viral in the same way as hate, then this problem can have some kind of, I don't know what shape it will take, but I guess it is imaginable that this problem that we are going through right now might have some sort of a solution. But attention spans, I don't think they have a direct relationship with these things.
Right.
Because we have always been tribal animals, very dependent on emotional responses in order to build communities. Attention deficit, attention, patience issues have other repercussions, which are not necessarily political. I think they have to do with our work lives, etc. The kind of work we do. There is a book by someone called Cal Newport. He's written a book called Deep Work, if you have heard of it. If you haven't, you should get it. It's about how social media feeds are scrolling so fast that we are not remaining in one place in our heads for any duration of time. You go from happy to sad to scary to, if you're just scrolling through your Facebook page, the number of things you see are so wildly divergent.
Yes.
And your brain is taking all of it in. Do that. And it's like, eating kurkure for a year. You're basically snacking your way to a bad health, bad mental health.
Right.
So we can't, like, I'll tell you, I'm a writer and I need a few months to write a story. And I have to make a conscious effort to stay away from news, etc., because it's overwhelming.
Right.
You need to put yourself in a certain frame of mind in order to be able to make creative work happen. And it is practically impossible for someone who's neck deep in social media to do that. So I take breaks just to write.
But what is the solution for this? Because the companies have become so large, right? And their only benefit is in keeping your eyeballs glued. Okay. And the only way to keep your eyeballs glued is to study your behavior and feed what you want so that you fall in this loop of information. So for example, what I do is like, I generally follow left-wing pages and I also follow right-wing pages because I don't want the algorithm to know me, right? I don't want the algorithm to read me as a person. I love non-veg, I love beef. I also follow vegan is the best and vegetarian is the best, right? So it's not everyone has the time to, think about it and they fall into this loop, right? They fall into this, the silos of their online online tribal communities in a sense, echo chambers. You know what I mean? And the moment you find your friend or your family in a different echo chamber in real life, it's just so weird. It's so weird.
Yeah, that's true. But also, I honestly don't know how we can get around the echo chamber problem because all the community, hate-based community problems that I just mentioned are emerging out of our reliance on echo chambers. We first, it was the echo chambers guiding the course of our news consumption. Now it is our news consumption itself, which has built itself around these behaviors. So once upon a time, our problem was that we were so we were getting trapped in echo chambers to such an extent that we were not able to, that we were not looking at the other point of view. Now news organizations have decided that they will only present one point of view to make things easier for us.
Yeah.
And as a result of that, everyone is fucked.
Right.
We have entire news organizations which are describing themselves as right wing and left wing when journalism doesn't even have wings.
Yeah.
Journalism is just reporting the truth. Usne wing kahan se?
And it's just this echo chambers have become so dangerous. I mean, like, people in the science fiction of the 1960s, thought that we would have flying cars in 2020. And we have people who are protesting against masks, right? Even the people from the educated countries of the Western world, right? I mean, we Indians are better in a sense of not opposing the mask, but we are weird with this pandemic in a different, entirely different way.
Different reasons.
Yeah, different way. But is it just sad to see the amount of scientific illiteracy around the world and especially in our country? And this pandemic has brought that out like khullam khulla. It just made dood ka dood, pani ka pani. And I can very clearly distinguish like this fellow is illiterate, this fellow is not.
Yeah. And it's not even about literacy because you have seen anti-mask sentiment. Coronavirus is not real. I personally know of one troll who's like extraordinarily, has no link with reality. He thinks Narendra Modi is a communist.
Okay. That's so, weird. So right. At least he should have called like at least Rahul Gandhi is a communist because at least he's on the left in some sense a left.
Yeah, but some kind of centrist approach. But yeah. I think uska ye hai ki climate change is not real, and Narendra Modi is a communist.
Okay.
So imagine what universe we live in. And I think what this happens because of is that emotional responses are more potent than reasonable responses. Man is not a rational animal. Man is an emotional animal. So when someone makes wearing masks about your nationalism, you don't wear masks. The solution to that is to make wearing masks about your babies, because that is also an emotional solution. So you fight emotion with emotion.
Right.
You can make as many rational arguments as you want to.
Right.
You will fail before emotion.
Interesting. So, I mean, that emotion can be very dangerous, right? Because companies use it to weird advertisements, right? For example, they make the airline about your grandmother, flying that airline about your grandmother. I mean, that's just blatant.
It's like the emotional approach is a magic sword. If it falls into the wrong hands, it will destroy the world or I'm just creating a random on the fly fantasy scenario. So the sword has to be in good hands.
The pun is intended, on the fly.
On the fly.
Right. How do you deal with trolls and stuff, sir? Because for the opinions that you have, how do you deal with trolls? And you obviously remove them, but does it depress you sometimes that, the amount of, the lack of better word, the lack of smart people around, rational people around you, not smart, but rational people around you, but people are so gullible and doesn't that make you sad?
No, because I have actually thought about this quite a lot. Mm-hmm. What I do is not about me. Mm. The reason smart people are not around someone is because the area around them has been poisoned by stupidity and hate and, all of that. What I try to do is that by removing stupid people and hateful people from my community, I create a space where smart people can come and talk and be themselves. Only by creating such spaces are we going to create a world where when you look around yourself, you're not surrounded by idiots. Right. So as far as my online communities are concerned, I'm like, I'll make it. I'll build that area. You come here, you talk to people, you be nice, you be civilized, because obviously you're not getting that in your ghar ka WhatsApp group. So this is going to be that space for you. So I remove trolls, not because they're a personal annoyance. I can take abuse for days on it. I've been on Twitter since 2006. I have seen all this happen grow in front of me. So that is not a problem. I remove trolls because I don't want people to urinate in my living room. I want it to be a nice place where nice people come and talk nice things.
Right.
That's it.
Right. And doing one last speculative fiction, right? Vaccine is going to come around in India, right? So what's going to happen? Like the first people that, do you know about these trips that, you know, travel companies are organizing? UK trip, 3 days back, one dose vaccine and shit like that. I mean, in a capitalistic world, that had to happen. That had to happen, right?
I honestly had not heard about the trips or a thing. But oh, it's yes. Not surprising.
It is real. Yeah. It is real.
It's not surprising. People will do that. Hmm. We have had this happen since earlier also, like when Ramdev came out with Korodil. Hmm. People have been trying to monetize it since day one. I saw ads for homeopathic medicines.
Yes.
On NDTV, of all places. Like the one channel you expect it to be slightly sensible. Hmm. On that channel, we have had ads for homeopathic remedies for coronavirus or, you know, stuff like that. So people are obviously going to always try to monetize things. And this is part of life in the year 2020, I guess.
I forwarded this message to my friend that this is just a so nauseating and a vomiting stuff that people, rich people, get to fly to get vaccine. What's wrong in this? And the friend asked me a reverse question, like, what is wrong? You tell me. I couldn't know where to begin, right? I just said think and just left from there. What is the answer for that? Why is it?
I think, listen, if people like you and I can pay more money for the vaccine, then we should. Hmm. As long as it becomes affordable or free for people who can't afford it. Hmm. Because we can afford to pay for it.
Right.
There are many who can't. Right. And it should not cost everyone 1,000 rupees for a vaccination. So people who should get charged for it should totally pay.
Right.
In fact, pay double. Hmm. Charge them double.
Right.
So that we have enough vaccines, enough of an infrastructure left to cater to those who don't have that money.
Right.
So that may be one way in which this is right.
No, my question is regarding how about the fact that we live in a world where, you know, there is people just get to fly away. You know what I mean? It's they get to fly away if they default the banks. They get to fly away if there's a vaccine. And it's there must be something problematic about the people who don't think this is a problem, right? It's just
this is one of the issues.
We have this weird fantasy, like, he's successful, he's rich, he can do anything he wants, man. He's rich, he earned it. He earned the right to cheat. Like, what the fuck?
Yeah, so I think this is one of the things even upper caste, middle class Indians will agree on, that nobody's a fan of Vijay Mallya.
Yeah.
Nobody's a fan of Vijay Mallya. Some people will be, you know, what's the word? Some people will be brazen about it and say, haan, toh chala gaya, kya kar sakte? But even they're not his fans.
Right.
Maybe they want to be him, but nobody will say that what he did was right.
Yes.
Which gives me a little bit of hope in the world, because a world that knows the difference between right and wrong is a world that can probably still be saved.
Interesting. Sir, to save this world, I mean, we don't need superheroes. We need artists and writers like yourself. And I love the work you do on your space, on your online community that you do, Words of Weapons. Can you please tell about your social media presence really quickly before I let you go?
I am mostly on Instagram and my handle is Vimo. That's V-I-M-O-H. Mm-hmm. Everything else steps from there. I have vimosworld.com, which is a newsletter cum podcast, which is going to start soon, hopefully. I have a YouTube channel, but primarily, if you want to connect with me, just come to Instagram, V-I-M-O-H.
Right. And your Twitter is Words of Weapons.
Yeah, same on Twitter and Instagram, V-I-M-O-H.
Excellent. That's it from the Solo Compass podcast, ladies and gents. Hope you enjoyed the chat. Thank you very much once again for Vijendra for joining this podcast.
It was my pleasure.
Till we see you next time, folks. Bye.